As a student of, you know, tribal problems, and so I try to understand, I'm a physicist otherwise, but I try to understand it in my simplistic way. And what I find is that the country is ruled by tribals, especially the states, where the chief minister is a tribal, there are civil servants who come from tribal community. Everywhere there has been so much of influx. Now, who is exploiting whom? I would like to know. Whether it is, you know, everybody is exploiting the tribal, the people from their community, the people who try to give them, get them a better deal. Everybody is trying to earn living out of the tribal's problem. So to me, it's quite a difficult thing to understand. Who is exploiting whom? The tribals are ruling this country. Say, you go to a state like Chhattisgarh, or you go to a state like Jharkhand, the chief minister is a tribal. The legislators are tribal. Now, it is their leaders who have to change their lives. So what are we doing there? There is a community where the leadership is emerging. And they try to change their life. The tribals come to city, they don't want to live in the villages. Or Maoists go and they exploit them. So don't you feel that it is it's a big exploitative industry which is working all the time in the name of tribal. The label is tribal welfare, but everybody is making their welfare. I don't know. This is a very straight question. I leave it to you for replying or not.
Thanks, I will modify that question a little bit. I say not an exploitative, a big exploitative.
Your mic is off.
I will modify your question a little bit for my convenience. I will not say a big exploitative industry, but I will say big exploitative industries. There are two types of industries here. One is political. That is, when a tribal joins a political party in a country where elections are not state-funded and where parties are expected to generate funds for themselves, where tribals have the minimum ability to generate funds in a political party, and there the tribal leaders remain at the tail end of a party. I mean, let's think of say two or three or four big political parties in the country and see if tribals are at the top, at the helm of the affairs of those political parties. We see they are still, you know, in some dark corners. They are still at the tail end of the political parties. These leaders, in order to ascend within their political hierarchy within the party, they follow the examples of other political leaders in our country. And that question is not exclusively a tribal question. Though tribals are complicity with that system, and they're not rebels. Tribals are not rejected out of hand the political system in the country. And therefore, when they belong to political parties, they behave like other politicians in the parties. And that is bad behavior. I feel terribly ashamed about that behavior as being an Indian. It is shocking, it is criminal, and needs to be dealt with as crime. But there is the other industry, and that is exploitative industry of collecting haftas as certain groups, gangs, which later evolve as small political outfits, then become political parties. We got that whole trajectory of like somebody from a village goes to city, starts collecting haftas, becomes a criminal, small time criminal, then a big criminal, then a don, that trajectory. And there we notice that the people in the name of ideologies have been collecting haftas and protection money from tribals. And these people who collect that protection money also include tribals themselves. There's a third industry, and that is money lending, because indebtedness has been there with the tribals since land ownership was uncertain, and uncertain land ownership leads to migration, indebtedness. And in areas of indebtedness, money lending becomes a thriving business where banks are not willing to provide access to loans, access to cash. Their tribals have become dadas, lending to other tribals. And that is actually imitating the rest of the society. And that's very sad. That's very sad. So, but I will not say that this, all these three instances are typical features of a tribal community. All that I will say is that tribal communities are also showing similar traits as other communities when they are placed within a similar economic transition. It's not peculiarly tribal, it is not peculiarly non-tribal. So, I feel sorry for that. But I will not therefore condemn all tribals and say, well, tribals, after all, I have heard some people saying, when tribals become officers, they become more corrupt than the others. And I do not think that is really the case empirically.